Hi, welcome friends. In yesterday's session or in earlier session, we have discussed few amendments. So this is my amendments in income tax. For AY 2021, correct, which is relevant to PY 1920, and on that, this is session number 2, relevant to PY 1920. This is, remember, session number 2. Don't forget to check session number 1, okay? Fine. So again, just reminding you, this is applicable for whom? This is applicable for CA, CS, and CMA student friends who are giving exams in May or June 2020. Correct? So, shall we go ahead? In 1 minute, I'll tell you that what all we had seen in session number 1. So, in session 1, we checked amendment in salaries, that is standard deduction is now rupees 50,000 instead of rupees 40,000. Then we have seen amendment in house property. I hope you remember it, that instead of one property, now two houses can be shown as self-occupied. And we have seen amendment in PGBP, that is the rate of depreciation on motor cars, okay, which were purchased from 23rd August 2019 till 31st March 2020 will be, yes, 30%, correct, instead of 15%. And for those motor cars which are used in business of running them on hire, it would be 45% instead of 30%. Absolutely correct. Then we had seen changes or amendments in taxation for companies. That was introduction of section 115 BAA and section 115 BAB. We have seen that these are the optional schemes or optional rates of tax. In 115 BAA, we have seen how it is 22% plus 10% surcharge plus health and education cess. And in case of 115 BAB, for manufacturing companies who have started their business with effect from 1st October 2019, how it is 15% plus 10% surcharge plus health and education cess, correct? Further, we have also discussed that now minimum alternate tax MAT percentage has become 15 plus, of course, surcharge if applicable, plus health and education cess. 15 instead of earlier 18.5%, correct? So I hope you remember all these things which we had discussed in our session number 1. Now let us understand few more amendments, okay, which will be applicable for AY 2021, okay, relevant to PY 1920, correct? So let's go to the word file in which I have done summary of all amendments. Yes, see this, I am here, correct. Income from salary done, HP done, PGBP's amendment done. Let's come to capital gains. Yes, very good. So as you know friends, that how we calculate capital gains, full value of consideration less expenses on transfer, correct? You know that gives you net sale consideration less, you subtract cost of acquisition slash indexed cost of acquisition slash, or you can say cost of improvement slash indexed cost of improvement, correct? And that gives you short-term capital gains slash long-term capital gains as the case may be, correct? And of course you take less exemption under section 54 onwards, 54, 54F, 54EC, and so on, and that gives you Yes, correct. That gives you taxable capital gains, whatever, short term, long term. Correct. Now, I want to tell you that when do we calculate this indexation benefit? You all are expert in it. Correct. Indexation is the benefit of indexation is taken when you are calculating long term capital gains. No need to tell you that. You know that. Correct. Now understand, how do you calculate indexed cost of acquisition and indexed cost of improvement? Let us quickly recollect. Okay. Now see, indexed cost of acquisition is equal to cost of acquisition multiplied by cost inflation index for PY, okay, in which transfer takes place. Correct? CI for PY, in which SAC transfers the capital asset upon CII for PY, in which SAC has acquired the capital asset. Now, please understand this CII, that is cost inflation index, is notified by government on year-to-year basis. It is somewhere linked to wholesale price index. This cost inflation index decided for financial year, or you can say previous year, 2019-20 is 289. Keep it in mind. So this is your CII for PY 1920. Got it? So whenever you're doing, for example, now in your exam, they will give you a question that SSE has sold a house, say in PY 1920. So you'll have to, and if you observe that the asset is long-term capital asset, then what you will do is cost of acquisition multiplied by CII for the PY in which asset is transferred upon CII for the PY in which asset is acquired. For that CII for the PY in which asset is transferred, that will be of course PY 1920. For that, the notified cost inflation index is 289. Please keep this in mind. Clear? Can I go ahead? Very good. Now see, one very important amendment in section 54. What is section 54? Let us try to recollect in few minutes. As I was telling you, where is this position of section 54? Correct. Section 54 is an exemption while calculating capital gains. We did full value of consideration, less expenditure on transfer. You got net sale consideration, less you did cost of acquisition or index cost of acquisition, cost of improvement or index cost of improvement. You got long-term capital gains or short-term capital gains, as the case may be. Now, less you do exemptions. These exemptions are under section 54, 54F, 54EC, and so on. Correct? And then you get taxable capital gains. Got it? So this is the position of that section 54. So that section 54 brings down the taxable capital gains. Clear? Sorry. As you know, that section 54 is, I am an SSE, individual SSE, I am selling one house. That house was a long-term capital asset that is held for more than 24 months. Correct? And now I'm investing in another house. Now I'll be getting exemption to the extent of long-term capital gains invested in that house. Clear? So in short, what government says that if SSE is selling one house and investing in another house, then exempt him from paying the tax to the extent he's investing in that house. Means, in simple language, if my long-term capital gains on sale of my house is, say, 50 lakhs, and I invest in new house, anything, say, which is up to 50 lakhs, means it is 50 lakhs or more than 50 lakhs, then entire 50 lakhs of LTCG will get exempted. So government wants to give me convenience of not paying tax. Clear? Now, so question is, sir, what is the amendment in this? So amendment is very simple. Listen, if my capital gains, long-term capital gains on sale of my house is not exceeding rupees 2 crores, then I may invest in two houses. Getting the point? So I'm given an option to invest in two houses. Earlier, such option was not there. Compulsorily, I had to invest only in one house. But now what is the situation? If long-term capital gains is not exceeding rupees 2 crores, then there's an option to invest in two houses in India. Getting the point? So this is one small amendment. Of course, if my LTCG exceeds rupees 2 crores, I have to compulsorily continue investing only in one house. I know it seems contradictory when the capital gain is high, the investment is only in one house. But when it is not exceeding 2 crores, option is given that investment could be done in, yes, two houses. Okay, so let's read this amendment and then maybe we can do one diagram and I can tell you that. See, so section 54. So I have written the full section here so it can be recollected. Eligible SSE, individual HUF. Conditions to be fulfilled, there should be transfer of residential house. Okay, it must be long-term capital asset. Income from such house should be chargeable under the head income from house property. And where the amount of capital gain exceeds rupees 2 crores. See, one residential house in India should be purchased, this time limit you know, within 1 year or 2 years after date of transfer or constructed within period of 3 years. No change in that. Issue is only this, that if amount of LTCG exceeds 2 crores, then invest in one residential house. And where the amount of capital gains does not exceed rupees 2 crores, SSE, that is individual or HUF, may at his option purchase two residential houses. Got it? Or construct two residential houses. Correct? And now see, this is once in a lifetime option as of now. So what they are saying? Where during any assessment year, SSE has exercised the option to purchase or construct two residential houses in India, he shall not be subsequently entitled to exercise the option for the same or any other assessment year. I hope you got it. See, with the help of this example. This implies that if an SSE has availed the option of claiming benefit of Section 54 in respect of purchase of two residential houses in Jaipur and Jodhpur, say in respect of capital gains of 1.5 crores, see that is less than 2 crores, arising from transfer of residential house at Mumbai in PY 1920, then he will not be entitled to avail benefit of Section 54 again in respect of purchase of two residential houses in, say, Pune and Baroda, in respect of capital gains of rupees 1.2 crores arising from transfer of residential house in Jaipur in PY 23-24, even though capital gains arising on transfer of residential house in Jaipur now is not exceeding rupees 2 crores. Got it? Means once in the life, if he exercises the option of purchasing two houses, then he cannot again exercise such option. Clear? So let me also summarize this with help of one table. So see, there is LTCG on transfer of house. Clear? And you are seeking to claim exemption of Section 54. Okay, you are seeking to claim exemption under Section 54. Clear? Now, what is your LTCG? There are two possibilities. Your LTCG is your LTCG amount is, say, up to means not exceeding rupees 2 crores. And second possibility is that it is above rupees 2 crores. Mind you, if it is up to rupees 2 crores, at option of SAC investment may be done in two houses. Where? Of course, in India. Clear? But such option once exercised cannot be exercised again. Such option once exercised cannot be exercised again. I hope you got it. Okay, if it is above 2 crores, there is no such option. There is no such option. Means what? It implies that compulsorily invest only in what? One house. Of course, in India. Is the point clear? Compulsory invest in one house in India. Is the point clear? Okay. So, pre-amendment, it was like whatever is your capital gains, you had to invest only in one house. That was the issue pre-amendment. But post-amendment, this particular point gets added. That is, this has happened with effect from AY 2021. Clear? Got it? Shall we go ahead? Have you taken this down? Very good. So they can easily ask you such question in the exam, in the upcoming exam. They will just ask you to calculate LTCG on sale of house. You know how to calculate that. Say it is 1.6 crores. That means not exceeding 2 crores. And then they will tell you that SSE wants to invest in 2 houses. Can he means 2 houses and claim exemption of section 54. Can you do so? So answer will be yes. But you will write a note that this option once exercised cannot again be exercised. Correct? Fine. Let's go ahead. So these were the amendments that I wanted to discuss from capital gains. Companies we have discussed in earlier session. Yes. Now let's come to amendments in TDS topic. Correct? Tax deducted at source. As you know that in TDS, one of the important section is section 194I. 194I is payment of rent. Correct? So you know that TDS in case of payment on rent is to be the deductor is any person except individual or HUF. And individual HUF is also covered if in the preceding financial year their turnover in business exceeded rupees, correct, 1 crore or in professional exceeded rupees 50 lakhs. So there is no change in those things, even there is no change in percentage. You know, percentage of TDS on rent in case of immovable property. Yes, can you recollect it? Correct. It is 10%. And in case of plant and machine, very good. It is 2%. Correct. And you know, as usual, that if PAN is not furnished by payee, PAN not furnished by payee, then as you know, that it is 20%. It is as per section 206A. This all things you know. Threshold limit has changed. Earlier, the threshold limit was, earlier, you know, threshold limit, right? Threshold limit means if the payment by payer to a particular payee in a year does not exceed this amount, then there is no need to deduct tax at source. So this threshold limit earlier was rupees 1,80,000 per annum. And now, what is the amendment? Amendment is, there is a relief. Now this threshold limit has become 2,40,000. So I want you to understand it. Don't remember this 1,80,000 now. 2,40,000 means what? Suppose I have taken as a businessman a premises on rent, and its rent is say 25,000 per month. So 25,000 into 12, 3 lakhs. It exceeds 2,40,000. Yes, so I'll be liable to deduct tax at source. Of course, if I'm individual, I have to check what was my turnover in last year. If as a payer, I'm company or a firm, then it is always mandatory. Of course, if this threshold exceeds this 2,40,000. Understood? Suppose now, the rent which I'm paying is say 15,000 per month. So 15,000 into 12, 1,80,000. Yes, what it is? Correct. 1,80,000. No need to deduct tax at source because it is not exceeding 2,40,000. Okay, clear. So threshold limit now is 2,40,000 per annum of section 194I. Clear. And as you know, in 194I, the threshold limit is for the overall rent. That means from a single person, I have taken property also on rent, immovable property also on rent, and plant and machine also on rent. For immovable property, say I am paying 1,20,000 per annum. And say for plant and machine, I am paying 1,30,000 per annum. So what's the total? Total I have to check. It is 2.5 lakhs. That is exceeding 2,40,000, and it will be mandatory to deduct tax at source. Of course, if I am a person liable for deducting tax at source as per 194I. Clear? So I have said a lot actually. Amendment is this simple. Earlier threshold limit was 1,80,000, but now threshold limit is 2,40,000. Correct? I hope you have got this amendment. Now, see what they have done. They have inserted one section in this TDS provisions, that is section 194M. Correct? So this 194M is a new insertion and will be applicable with, means for the first time you will be reading this 194M in this financial year. So let's see what it is saying. TDS on payment made by individual or Hindu undivided family for contract work or by way of fees for professional services or commission or brokerage. Your question will be, sir, already we have for contract 194C, for professional services we have 194J, for commission and brokerage we have 194H. Then what is the need of section like 194M? Understand, this is for the personal payments, for excessive personal payments which are made by individuals or HUF. Those need to be tracked, and for them they have inserted such section like 194M. Correct? So see, applicability and rate of TDS. Section 194M inserted with effect from 1st September 2019. Can you highlight that date? So you know, all such payments which we are discussing in this 194M made on or after 1st September 2019 will come under scanner of this particular section. What is the percentage? It provides for deduction of tax at the rate of 5% by an individual or HUF responsible for paying any sum during the financial year to any resident. For what? For carrying out any work in pursuance of a contract or by way of commission, okay, or brokerage, or by way of fees for professional services. Clear? It may be noted that only individuals and HUF, mind you, bold it, highlight it, other than those who are required to deduct tax as per provisions of Section 194C or 194H or 194J. So if you are covered in 194C, 194H or 194J for these particular payments, then don't deduct and don't apply yourself to the Section 194M. Okay, are required to deduct tax in respect of above sums payable during the financial year to a resident. What is the time of deduction? It should be deducted at the time of credit of such sum or at the time of payment of such sum, whichever is earlier. And now, friends, the most happy news: no need to deduct tax at source if such payment is not exceeding rupees 50 lakhs per annum to the particular payee. Are you getting it? So threshold is kept at 50 lakhs. So you know, basic intention is not to cover small small payments. Basic intention of this Section 194M is to cover a heavy payment, heavy amount done to a payee on account of either professional services, contract, okay, or commission or brokerage. Okay, what is the threshold limit? Mind you, 50 lakh rupees per annum, and there is no requirement to obtain tax deduction account number, that is TAN, by the payer, because you know this payer is such payer who is doing a personal payment, so he may not be having TAN, that is tax deduction account number. So it is totally acceptable. Okay, so let us quickly recollect 194M. So can I say that it is applicable to individual and HUF? Such individual HUF whose such payment is not covered under Section 194C, 194H and 194J. This point is clear. Such individual HUF is covered here. Most important is threshold limit. Threshold limit is rupees 50 lakhs during an year, or you can say during a year to a pay. To a pay. Okay? Towards, okay, that towards will cover in next point. That threshold limit is very important, so I'm first putting it, and payment towards. In this section, we are covering payment towards one, contract work, professional fees, or you can say professional services and commission or brokerage. Correct? And these all payments we are covering for, if you are doing these payments for personal purposes. I hope you got it. Correct? And very one more important point from compliance perspective is, such individual HUF need not obtain, yes, such individual HUF need not obtain TAN. So just let me put that point here, that no need to obtain tax deduction account number, no need to obtain TAN to comply with these provisions. So even if you need to deduct tax at source under this 194M, there is no need to obtain TAN. Yes, and one point which I forgot to tell you, forgot to summarize, is rate. What is the rate of TDS here? Rate of TDS, whenever applicable, is 5% in this case. Correct? So I hope that I have covered for you all these points in section what? 194M. Clear? Any doubts, do let me know. Shall we go ahead? Very good. Chalo. Let's go ahead. 194N. This is also creativity done in this particular, done with respect, or you can say with effect from this AY only. Let's see what is this 194N. Okay. So, you know, many times provisions of TDS will have intention, of course, rather than collecting tax, it will have intention of bringing those transactions under the scanner of the officers, that is the income tax department. What is this 194N? See, section 194N, inserted with effect from 1st September 2019, provides that every person being banking company, cooperative society, post office, who is responsible for paying in cash any sum or aggregate of sums exceeding rupees 1 crore during the PY. So please underline the threshold, 1 crore, okay, to any person from one or more accounts maintained by such recipient persons with it, shall deduct tax at source at 2% of the sum exceeding rupees 1 crore. So please understand, this is TDS on cash withdrawals. In simple language, section 194N is TDS on cash withdrawals. Did you understand? It is TDS on cash withdrawals. That's why they are saying, no, that person who is responsible to deduct tax at source is bank or a cooperative society. Okay, now please understand, TDS on cash withdrawals, here this section will apply, this section will apply only after withdrawals of rupees, only after withdrawals of rupees 1 crore during a PY. Understood? And what is the rate of TDS? Correct. Rate of TDS is 2%. Understood? So this limit I cannot call as threshold limit. It's a very unique limit in TDS that if suppose withdrawal of particular assessee from bank, multiple banks account maintained with bank is say 1 crore 50 lakhs. Then during the year, then TDS will be only on rupees 50 lakhs at 2%. Clear? Let's see. Time of deduction. It is to be made at the time of payment of such sum and non-applicability of TDS under section 194N. Liability to deduct tax at source under section 194N shall not be applicable to any payment made to government, bank, cooperative society, business correspondence of banking company or cooperative society, and any white label ATM operator, that means ATM operator of that bank or cooperative society. And right has been given to central government to, you know, notify such persons to whom this provision shall not apply. Clear? So this is 194N. So that, you know, heavy cash withdrawals of some assessees can be brought in the can be brought under the scanner. Clear? Let us go ahead. Understood? Now comes important topic of rates of income tax. As you know, rates of income tax, this is subject matter of Finance Act. Every Finance Act will give the particular percentage of income tax. Correct? So, now we will check rates of income tax as per Finance Act 2019, which will be applicable for AY as we are checking 2021. That is PY 1920. Correct? Let's see. First, we will check for individuals. So I will tell you one simple thing. For individuals, Hindu undivided family, check. Association of person, body of individuals, and all artificial juridical persons. Correct? It goes as per slabs. What are the slabs? Very simple slabs. For individuals, can I say except? You understood who those are. Correct? They go as per slabs. What are the slabs? First 0 to 2. Means up to first 2.5 lakhs, there is no tax. For income which falls between 2.5 to 5 lakhs, tax is at, as you know, 5%. Clear, na, this point? For income which falls between 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, tax is at, as you know, 20%. And for income above, rupees 10 lakhs, tax is at 30%. Understood? These slabs, you know, these slabs are for individuals who are other than resident, senior citizen or super senior citizen. Senior citizen or super senior citizen. Correct? Understood? So let's read it formally. And of course, we have to learn that along with rebate and along with surcharge. Let's see. Where total income does not exceed rupees 2,50,000, nil. Where total income exceeds 2,50,000 but does not exceed 5 lakh, 5% of the amount by which total income exceeds 2,50,000. Clear? Very straightforward. And where total income exceeds 5 lakh but does not exceed 10 lakh, then 12,500, which was on first 2,50,000, plus 20% of the amount by which total income exceeds rupees 5 lakhs. And then where total income exceeds 10 lakhs, then you know, first 2.5 lakhs there was no tax, 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs, there was 12,500, 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, at 20% on this 5 lakhs was 1 lakh, so 1 lakh 12,500 on first 10 lakhs, plus 30% of the amount by which total income exceeds rupees 10 lakhs. Getting it? Now, for senior citizen and super senior citizen, what I have to understand is everything remains same except for the basic exemption limit. First of all, what is definition of senior citizen? Okay, so I want, first of all, please keep in mind, I want resident senior citizen or I want resident super senior citizen to apply this special, you can say special basic exemption, correct? So, senior citizen means who is resident and whose age during the PY is 60 or more than 60. Okay, so what is basic exemption limit for them? Basic exemption limit for them is rupees 3 lakh instead of 2,50,000. And resident super senior citizen, that is such assessee who is resident individual and whose age is 80 or more than 80 during the PY, for them basic exemption limit is rupees 5 lakhs. So for them the slabs start from 5 lakhs. Correct? Let's see. For senior citizen, being resident individual of age of 60 or more but less than 80, because if it is 80 or more than 80, we will call them as resident super senior citizen. See, A point is where total income does not exceed 3 lakh. It is nil. Okay. B point, read, when it is between 3 lakh to 5 lakh, whatever is the income, on that it is 5%. Then if income is between 5 to 10 lakhs, then on first 3 lakhs nothing, 3 lakh to 5 lakh, on that 2 lakhs you have calculated at 5%, which is 10,000. So that 10,000 plus, see, plus 20% of the amount by which total income exceeds rupees 5 lakhs. And if the total income is exceeding 10 lakhs, then on first 3 lakhs, as you know, nothing. 3 to 5 lakhs, you have calculated 10,000. 5 lakh to 10 lakh at 20%, you have calculated 1 lakh. So see, 1 lakh 10,000 plus 30% of the amount by which total income exceeds 10 lakhs. Clear? Absolutely similar working will continue for resident super senior citizen, but as I told you, with basic exemption limit of rupees 5 lakhs. So on first 5 lakhs, nil. Okay? But understand, if my income is above 5 lakhs but not exceeding 10 lakhs, then by whatever amount it exceeds 5 lakhs, it is at 20% as stated in the B point. And if it exceeds 10 lakhs, then on first 5 lakhs nothing, then next 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, that is on that 5 lakhs at 20% is 1 lakh. So see, 1 lakh plus 30% of the amount by which total income exceeds rupees 10 lakhs. Clear? And friends, there is one very important clarification. This is not new, but I thought that I should convey this to you. Okay? It's a very important clarification, and it will be applicable for those whose birthday falls on 1st April. April Fools, as my brother's birthday falls. So, a very important point for them, only for these special persons. What is the point for them? See, as I told you, that there is one individual whose birthday is on, say, 1st April 2020. And on this 1st April 2020, he attains the age of 60. So actually speaking, in which PY he has attained 60? It is actually in PY 2021. Correct? So he should become resident senior citizen for the first time in 2021. But government says, wait, we will give them benefit of being resident senior citizen under Income Tax Act with effect from PY 1920 itself. Clear? Similar thing will happen for resident super senior citizen. Got it? So this benefit only and only for those whose birthday falls on April 1st. Clear? Let's see. So I'll read out that circular for you. So see, clarification regarding attaining prescribed age of 60/80 on 31st March itself in case of senior or very senior citizen whose date of birth falls on 1st April. Borderline case actually. See, individual who is resident in India and of age of 60 years or more, that is senior citizen, and 80 years or more, that is very senior citizen, is eligible for higher exemption limit of rupees 3 lakhs and rupees 5 lakh respectively, as you know. CBDT has via this circular clarified that a person born on 1st April would be considered to have attained particular age on 31st March itself, that is the day preceding the anniversary of his birthday. Okay, so in particular, the question of attainment of age of eligibility for being considered a senior citizen or very senior citizen would be decided on the basis of above criteria. Therefore, a resident individual whose 60th birthday falls on 1st April 2020 would be treated as having attained age of 60 years in PY 1920 and would be eligible for higher exemption limit of rupees 3 lakhs. Got it? So they will enjoy that privilege in computing tax liability for AY 2021. Likewise, resident individual whose 80th birthday falls on 1st April 2020 would be treated as having attained age of 80 years in PY 1920 and would be eligible for higher basic exemption limit of rupees 5 lakhs in computing his tax liability for AY 2021. So I hope you have got it. So just I'll summarize that point, that circular. So example 60th birthday, 60th birthday of Mr. X is on 1st April 2020. Clear? So, 60th birthday of Mr. X, resident SAC, correct, is on 1st April 2020. So, what will happen? Effect in PY 1920, his status will be resident senior citizen. Clear? And accordingly, basic exemption limit of rupees, yes friends, ₹3 lakhs shall apply. Clear? Suppose birthday is on 2nd April 2020, 60th birthday. Then mind you, he will, this circular will not apply, and he will become resident senior citizen for the first time in PY 2021. Clear? As usual. So as I told you, this facility only for those whose birthday falls on 1st April. Clear? So I just thought that let me clarify this point for all of you. Fine. Now I am not going to stop at this point discussing only the slabs, because you know, so of course for firm all these things will go afterwards. First let's discuss this surcharge for individuals, because individuals tax liability computation will not be complete unless and until we discuss surcharge for them. So what is surcharge? Surcharge is a tax on tax. So because of this tax on tax, what happens is the effective rate of income tax goes up, correct? So how is this surcharge applicable? Let's try to understand. And this surcharge is also usually, not usually, it is given by Finance Act itself, correct? Let's discuss what is the surcharge percentage for individuals, correct? Let's discuss what is the surcharge rates for AY 2021, especially you know I want to discuss for individual HUF, AOP, BOI. So I will just say here for individuals etc. You please understand that. So you know surcharge is applicable when total income exceeds a particular amount. Clear? So government's intention is those assessees who have excessive income, their income tax percentage should be bit higher than others, and therefore they apply surcharge, that is tax on tax. So total tax payable that by them will be tax as per slabs plus surcharge on that tax subtotal plus health and education cess on that. Okay, fine. Let's see. So if TI means total income, if total income is exceeding how much, mind you, if total income is exceeding rupees 50 lakhs but not exceeding what, rupees 1 crore, then surcharge is at 10%. Please keep this in mind. Got it? Now I will use short forms. If total income is between, means exceeding 1 crore but not exceeding rupees 2 crores, then this surcharge is at 15%. So 10 increases to 15, and of course this is off tax that I have explained you. And now if total income is exceeding 2 crores but not exceeding rupees 5 crores, then mind you, surcharge is at 25%. And if total income is exceeding what? If it is exceeding rupees 5 crores, then surcharge is at a whopping 37%. I hope you got this percentages of surcharge. Don't worry, we are going to apply that also, so that you know how to calculate tax liability also, and you know means how to apply slabs also and surcharge also. Let's see. Got it? So keep this in mind. If total income exceeds 50 lakhs but does not exceed rupees 1 crore, 10%. If total income exceeds 1 crore but does not exceed 2 crores, 15%. If total income exceeds 2 crores but does not exceed 5 crores, 25%. And if total income exceeds 5 crores, 37%. Clear? Same thing I have put here. Okay? So, now point is we should check, for individuals we should check this annexure, which I have just put here. Let's see. See, I have put this annexure here. Please read this. Now what happens? That individuals' total income can have multiple incomes, means the five heads, which makes total income. Correct or not? Salary, HP, PGBP, capital gain, IOS. This gives GTI less deductions under chapter 6A. This gives total income. On this total income, you calculate tax, isn't it? Okay, on plus you calculate surcharge, plus health and education cess. This is total payable, right? This surcharge is if applicable, isn't it? Now understand. There could be some special incomes in this, especially in this CG. I want to talk about two special incomes. One is under 111A and one is under 112A. What is 111A and 112A? 111A is short-term capital gains on sale of shares. Which shares? Such shares which are listed. And what is 112A? It is long-term capital gains. Again, on sale of shares. Which shares? Such shares again which are sorry, such shares again which are listed. Clear? This 111A is payable at, this tax is at, sorry, this is at 15%. And this 112A is at, mind you, just let me use another color. This is at 10% on LTCG in excess of rupees 1 lakh. Clear? You got this percentages? Now understand. For them, one particular point is given. Read this. There's a press release, we have to apply that. So, read this. According to this press release, see the press release dated 24th August 2019. Got it? The enhanced surcharge of 25% and 37% on income tax, as the case may be, applicable where total income of individuals HUF and so on so exceeds 2 crores and 5 crores respectively, has been withdrawn on income tax payable at special rates. Can you underline that this enhanced surcharge of 25% and 37% of income tax. Okay. Has been withdrawn on what? Income tax payable at special rates of short-term capital gains under 111A and long-term capital gains under 112A arising from transfer of equity shares in company or unit of an equity-oriented fund or business trust which has been subject to STT. Okay, now what is the effect of this? See, consequently, the manner of computation of surcharge on income tax in case of individuals, HUF and so on for AY 2021 would be as follows. So we are interested in this, that how consequently the computation will take place. Okay, let's read it. See, and of course we'll solve this. Now see, what are the five cases they have given you? This is as per the ICI module, rather ICI amendments, and of course applicable for all professional exams. Even company secretary students and CMA students should not neglect it. It is actually how calculation will take place. See, first, so by designing different cases, we will be clarifying it. See, where total income, including income under section 111A and 112A, exceeds 50 lakhs, correct, but does not exceed rupees 1 crore. Are you there with me? Clear. Now there is no issue. My income is exceeding 50 lakhs, but it's not exceeding 1 crore. So of course, surcharge percentage will be 10. No prizes for guessing. Now they have given you an example. Your short-term capital gains is 30 lakhs under 111A. Long-term capital gains, mind you, if there is normal short-term capital gains and normal long-term capital gains, I don't need to apply this, whatever we are discussing. This is only if normal STC, only if STCG of 111A and 112A is involved. Okay. So I have made one Excel sheet for you where I have given you these examples. These five examples, I have solved it, which I now just want you to observe. And of course, you can take up this and solve. See what are they saying? What is my STCG? 30 lakhs. What is my LTCG? 25 lakhs. Take on your calci. 30 lakh plus 25 lakhs, 55 lakhs plus other income, 40 lakhs total, 95 lakhs. Got it? On this 95 lakhs, you will calculate tax. How you will calculate tax? I'll tell you. See, on that 30 lakhs, you will calculate at 15%. Do it. On LTCG of 112A, which is of 25 lakhs, you can't calculate on full 25 lakhs because you know first 1 lakh is not taxed. So calculate on 24 lakhs at 10%. Yes. And now on balance, you will calculate as per slabs. Correct? Now, when you do that, you will be getting total tax. On that total tax, you directly calculate surcharge at 10%. Clear? Because there is no issue of, increasing the surcharge. There is no issue of unnecessary surcharge, percentage of surcharge being taxed on LTC, this LTCG and STCG. So, continue taxing at the lowest rate, that is 10%, because your income, including that STCG, LTCG, is within 1 crore. Okay, but why to apply surcharge? Because it exceeds 50 lakhs. Let's see. So, see, what is my observation? The total income is 95 lakhs. So, what solution I have written? Here, total income, including income under 111A and 112A, exceeds 50 lakhs, but does not exceed 1 crore. Hence, surcharge shall be at 10% on entire income. Clear? See, we have calculated tax on STCG. What was your STCG? See, 30 lakhs. On 30 lakhs, we have computed at 15%. What is 30 lakhs into 15%? Correct? 4,50,000. Then, on LTCG under 112A, which is 25 lakhs. 25 lakhs minus 1 lakh, got 24 lakhs into 10%, 2,40,000. then what you do is balance income is 40 lakhs. On 40 lakhs, calculate tax. So here I will tell you in detail how to do it. Up to 2.5 lakhs, nil. 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs, that is on that 2,50,000 at 5%, 12,500. Between 5 lakh to 10 lakh at 20%, that is 1 lakh. Above 10 lakhs at 30%. So above 10 lakhs, how much you had? Check. You had 30 lakhs. So 30 lakhs into 30% is 9 lakh. If you take total of nil plus 12,500 and 1 lakh and 9 lakh, you get 10 lakh 12,500. Now take total of the tax, all taxes, means 111A's tax of 4,50,000, 112A tax of 2,40,000, and normal tax of 10 lakh 12,500. That total will be, check, that total will be 17 lakh 2,500, and then add a surcharge at 10% because your total income exceeded 50 lakhs but is not exceeding 1 crore. So you have calculated 10% of 17 lakh 2,500, which is 1 lakh 70,250. Add that, you will get subtotal of 18 lakh 72,750. And add health and education cess at 4%, so you will get total tax of 19,47,660. Correct? You should all check on your Calci and get this answer. It's already rounded off to nearest of 10, so nothing is to be done. Correct? Got it? So in this calculation, you understand that if total income includes special incomes, then how to do it? First, calculate tax on special incomes, then calculate tax on other income, take its total, apply surcharge as applicable, take total of tax and surcharge, then apply health and education cess at 4%. You will get the tax. Is the first example clear? Okay, now let's go to second point. What is the second point? They say, where total income, including income under section 111A and 112, exceeds 1 crore but does not exceed 2 crores. Got the point? Then what is the surcharge percent? Surcharge percentage is 15. Okay, on entire amount. Because see, the press release was saying, don't apply higher percentages of 25 and 37 to the 111A and 112A's tax. Correct? So till 15 it is okay. So now in the example, that is in the this column, check, just neglect this. Just one sec. Yeah, I don't know, just neglect it. See, so you know what I'm reading. I am reading this second point. Yes. What is the STCG? STCG is, just follow this. Yes. Follow this hand. 60 lakhs. LTCG under 112 is 65 lakhs. Take total. 60 plus 65. Is it 125 lakhs plus 50 lakhs other income? So what is that? Is it 175 lakhs? See, that means it exceeds, correct, 1 crore but does not exceed 2 crore. So now surcharge will be at, as discussed, 15%. Apply 15% surcharge on entire tax which you calculate on that 1 crore 75 lakhs. Let's see now how to do it. Before I go to the solution, imagine and visualize what you have to do. On STCG of 60 lakhs, you will be calculating at 15%, correct? On LTCG of 112A of 65 lakhs, you don't tax first 1 lakh. You tax 64 lakhs at, correct, you tax 64 lakhs at 10%. And other income, do it as per slabs. let's see the working. Going to example 2, see, correct? This is the example. What solution I'm telling you? That here, total income, including STCG under 111A and LTCG under 112A, exceeds 1 crore but does not exceed 2 crores, and hence surcharge at 15% on entire total income of 1.75 crores. Let's see. So, on 60 lakhs, we have calculated at 15%, which comes to 9 lakhs. Check on your calci. On 64 lakhs, that is 65 lakhs minus 1 lakh, 64 lakhs at 10%, 6,40,000, and other income was 50 lakhs. On first 2.5 lakhs nil, 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakh 12,500, 5 lakh to 10 lakh at 20%, 1 lakh, above 10 lakhs is 40 lakhs, on 40 lakhs at 30%, 12 lakhs, take total, 13,12,500. Now take total of 9 lakh, 6,40,000 and 13,12,500. Yes, the total is 28,52,500. Add surcharge. Sorry. Add surcharge at 15%. Correct? It is 4,27,875. Your subtotal will be 32,80,375. Then add health and education cess at 4%. This would be 1,31,215. Got it? And total tax would be 34,11,590. Is it okay? Have you got it? So in these two situations, there was no issue, correct? Because whatever was the overall surcharge applicable, that you applied on the overall income without any distinction between surcharge on, you know, 111A and 112A. Clear? Let's go to third situation. Third situation is interesting. Follow the, yes, follow the hand. This pointer, follow this pointer. Where total income excluding income under 111A and 112A exceeds 2 crores, correct, but does not exceed 5 crores, means your total income excluding what, which income, 111A and 112A exceeds 2 crores but does not exceed 5 crores. Now you know that you have landed in the surcharge of 25%. Now what you should do is, you should apply 25% of surcharge on this income, but on 111A and 112A's tax, the surcharge will be restricted to 15%. So see, rate of surcharge on income tax payable on portion of income chargeable to tax under 111A and 112A is not exceeding 15%. Clear? Now see the example. It will become interesting now. STCG under 111A is 54 lakhs. LTCG under 112A is 55 lakhs. And other income is 3 crores. Can you see other income is exceeding 2 crores but not exceeding 5 crores? Means on other income it becomes mandate to charge at? Correct? Yes, to charge at 25%. Yes. And on 54 and 55 lakhs, that is on this STCG under 111A and LTCG under 112A, on that whatever tax you calculate, on that surcharge will be only at 15%. Let's see. So, you know, whatever I may say, but only showing you the practical solving will help you for understanding. See what they are saying in the last column, then we'll go to the Excel sheets solution. Surcharge would be levied at 15% on income tax on STCG of 54 lakhs, chargeable to tax under 111A, and LTCG of 55 lakhs, chargeable to tax under 112A. And surcharge at 25% would be leviable on income tax computed on other income of 3 crores included in total income. Clear? Now, let's see. how it is being done. This example number 3. 54 lakhs is your STCG under 111A. 55 lakhs is your LTCG under 112A. Correct? Observe. Observe it. Are you observing it? Yes. Correct. Are you observing it? And 3 crores is your other income. Now what happens is your total income is 4 crore 9 lakhs. Fine. Let's see. Here total income excluding STCG under 111A and LTCG under 112A exceeds 2 crores but does not exceed 5 crores. And hence surcharge on such other income shall be at 25% of tax on such income. Moreover, on tax on STCG under 111A and LTCG under 112A, surcharge shall be at 15%. Let's see the calculation, okay? Check. On 54 lakhs, that STCG, calculate at 15%. It should be 8,10,000. On LTCG, of 55 lakhs minus 1 lakh, that is 54 lakhs, calculate at 10%. That should be 5,40,000. Clear? Let's come to that balance. Balance is how much? Yes, 3 crores. Let's come to that balance of 3 crores. On first 2.5 lakhs, no tax. I should not explain you till 10 lakhs now. You know, 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs, 12,500, 5 lakh to 10 lakh, 1 lakh. And above 10 lakhs. Above 10 lakhs is how much? Here. It is 2 crore 90 lakhs. That 2 crore 90 lakhs into 30%, which is 87 lakhs. Take total of 87 lakh, 1 lakh and 12,500 and nil. It will be 88,12,500. Take total of 8,10,000, 5,40,000 and 88,12,500. So far so good. It should be 1,01,62,500. Clear? Now comes the point of surcharge. Correct? Now see what to do. You know, on STCG and LTCG of 111A and 112A, whatever is the tax, see the tax is 8,10,000 and 5,40,000. On that, you should calculate surcharge at 15%. See? So what we have done, 8,10,000 plus 5,40,000, correct? On that you have calculated surcharge at 15%, which see comes to 2,02,500. Clear? And on other income, that is 88 lakh, means the tax on other income, that is 88,12,500. On that we have calculated surcharge at 25%. Correct. Now this is your total of surcharge, 24,05,625. So your total tax is 1,01,62,500 plus 24,05,625. So total tax is 1,25,68,125, which rounded off will become 1,25,68,130. Clear? This is how you did this particular point. Now see the fourth point. Follow this pointer as usual. This pointer you follow. Now point is, you know, what is pending now? Where total income excluding income under 111A and 112A exceeds 5 crores. Correct? What should happen now? Now the surcharge will be at 37% on other income. But you know, on 111A and 112A is income, the surcharge will continue to be at 15%. So see, rate of surcharge on income tax payable on portion of income chargeable to tax under 111A and 112A shall not exceed 15%. Correct? Let's go to example now. STCG is how much? in our example, 50 lakhs. LTCG, when I say STCG, LTCG, now you understand that it is under those particular sections. LTCG is 65 lakhs. So see, 1115 lakhs and 6 crores is your other income. Getting it? Now see what will happen. Surcharge at 15% would be levied on income tax on STCG of 50 lakhs chargeable to tax under 111A and LTCG of 65 lakhs chargeable to tax under 112A. And surcharge at 37% would be leviable on income tax computed on other income of 6 crores included in total income. Clear? Let's see how. Let's see this example here. Check. STCG under 111A, 50 lakhs. LTCG under 112A, 65 lakhs. Other income, 6 crores. Total income becomes 7 crore 15 lakhs. Now see what we are saying. Here total income excluding 111A and 112A exceeds 5 crores. Hence the rate of surcharge on tax of such income shall be 37%. While on STCG and LTCG of that 111A and 112A shall be at 15%. Correct? On tax on such incomes. Let's see the calculation. Check. This STCG is 50 lakhs. On this 50 lakhs we calculated at 15%, which is 7,50,000. LTCG is 65 lakhs. You subtracted first 1 lakh. And on 64 lakhs you calculated at 10%, which is 6,40,000. And your balance income is 6 crores. So you came up to first 10 lakhs, no problem. No tax on 2.5 lakhs. 12,500 on income between 2.5 lakhs to 5 lakhs. 5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, you know, 1 lakh. And now on income above 10 lakhs. Above 10 lakhs here is 5 crore 90 lakhs. 5 crore 90 lakhs into 30%. Check. It should be 1 crore 77 lakh. Take total of 1 crore 77 lakh and 1 lakh and 12,500. Should be 1 crore 78 lakh 12,500. Take total of 7,50,000, 6,40,000 and 1 crore 78 lakh 12,500. It should be 1 crore 92 lakh 2,500. Got it? Now comes the important calculation of surcharge. See, surcharge is tax on tax, correct. So what is tax of 111A and 112A? 7,50,000 and 6,40,000. So on that 7,50,000 and 6,40,000, surcharge will be at 15%. Check. Which comes to 2,08,500. You do keep on doing all calculations on your Calc. You don't have facility of this Excel sheet. Means you have, but in exam you can't use it. So now also you should practice on calculator only. And on this 1 crore 78 lakh 12,500, you have to apply at 37%. So total surcharge, mind you, is 67,99,125. And now total tax will become 1 crore 92 lakh 2,500 plus 67,99,125, that is 2 crore 60 lakh 1,625. On that, you add health and education cess at 4%, which will be 10,40,065. And your total tax will be 2 crore 70 lakh 41,690. Clear? So, you know, institute can ask you such questions in this exam. Be careful. Correct? So what they had given you in the verbal, or you can say statement form, we are just doing its computations in detail. And lastly, last case would be where total income, are you there? Fifth case now? Because as it is, I am giving you these Excel sheets also in your comment section or in the description of the video. But don't rely on that. Do your calculations. While I am solving, you should also solve. Pause the video, solve. Take initiative. See, where total income, including income under 111A and 112 exceeds 2 crores and these cases are not covered in 3 and 4 above, then now what happens? Apply at 15%. Correct? So see, STCG under 111A, 60 lakhs. Example they have given you. LTCG under 112A, 55 lakhs. So now see, another income is 1.1 crore. 1.1 crore and the addition of both will give you 2.25 crores. Of course, on this entire 2.25 crores tax, you will calculate surcharge at 15%. Clear? So see, that also working I have shown you here. 2 crore 25 lakhs is your total income. Since total income exceeds 2 crores, surcharge would be at 15%. So you know there should be no injustice, you can say, of higher percentage of 25 and 37 on tax of 111A and 112A. That is the intention of this press release. Okay, so see, STCG is 60 lakhs. On that 60 lakhs, calculate at 15%. On next 55 lakhs, first 1 lakh is not taxed. So on 54 lakhs at 10% is 5,40,000. Balance of 1 crore 10 lakhs slabs need not explain you till 10 lakhs. Above 10 lakhs, it is 1 crore. So 1 crore into 30% is 30 lakhs. Take total 31,12,500. Now take total of tax including 111A and 112A tax. That will be 9 lakh plus 5,40,000 plus 31,12,500. Total would be 45,52,500. Directly add surcharge at 15%. You will get total. Then add health and education cess at 4%. And then you will get total tax. Clear? So I hope you have paused the video at specific points, solved all the things with you, and have done it systematically, because finally you have to give the exams. And for any doubts, please feel free to anytime comment, contact me on the phone number given, whatever is convenient for you. So my question is simple to you: is the rates of surcharge and their applicability keeping in consideration that press release, is it clear to all of you? Correct? So I'll continue with the topic of rates of income tax. If you're tired, don't want to watch the whole video at one stroke, you have the always option of pausing it, taking a break and then watching. Because what you are learning is something new for you, obviously. But I have done it quite a few times, so of course, I'll not get tired discussing these things with you. But grasping these things, you might become tired to some extent. So that's why I'm telling you, making you aware. It's nothing like the whole video you have to watch at one stretch. Fine. So we have just now discussed rates of tax for individual, Hindu undivided family, association of person, body of individual, and artificial juridical person. Clear? Now we will go ahead and discuss normal rates of tax for others. So, for others, company we have already discussed in earlier video. Now, let us discuss for firm. There's not much to discuss. There's a flat taxation of 30%. For local authority, again, flat taxation of 30%. For both of them, how are the surcharge? See, simple. Where total income exceeds 1 crore, surcharge is payable at 12% of total income. Clear? Of course, income tax. Not total income, of income tax. And for cooperative society, what is the percentage? It's again as per slabs. If the income is up to, for first 10,000, 10%. When it is between 10,000 to 20,000, then 1,000 for that first 10,000, and whatever exceeds 10,000, and up to 20,000 it is then 20%. Okay, and where the total income is exceeding 20,000, then 3,000. How 3,000? On first 10,000, 1,000. On next 10,000, 2,000. 1 plus 2, 3,000. 3,000 plus 30% of the amount by which total income exceeds 20,000. Okay, so this is how you will apply slabs for cooperative society. Okay, and companies, so we have already discussed. Okay, so now let me do one, especially let me do one chart or one summary for surcharge. Correct? Surcharge summary. I will just say individual, etc. You know which categories fall in this. Correct? Then I will tell you company. Then I will tell you cooperative society. Correct? Yes. Tell me who else? Local authority. And then tell me who else. That's it, your feeling. Okay, even firm. Yes, absolutely correct. Even firm includes LLP also. Understand? For individuals, already discussed, TI means total income less than or equal to. Okay, not less than, more than. Okay, can I say for individuals, already discussed. And can I just say, because we had an extensive discussion on that. Correct? Can I just say here 10% for some category, then 15%, 25%, and finally 37%. It all depends on total income and it is off tax. Surcharge is off tax. Correct? So, more than 50 lakhs but less than 1 crore. Correct? If it is more than 1 crore, less than, yes friends, 2 crores. More than 2 crores, less than 5 crores. Perfect. And more than 5 crores. Absolutely correct. Clear? So, you know, while studying, study very extensively with examples. And then systematically summarize. So this summary will help you one day before the exam. And in company, I should bifurcate for domestic companies and for foreign companies. Yes or no? For domestic companies and for foreign company. So let's see what are the surcharges. See, understand, where I have given it to you, I will show you the place. See this, I had given you, we had discussed taxation for companies, in that I have given you surcharge for domestic company. Okay, see this, it is 7% in some cases and it is 12% in some cases, that's it. Not a complication like individuals. See, and in this individuals now, keep in mind also that press release with respect to 111A and 112A. Okay, in case of company, where it is 7 and where it is 12. See, very simple. If total income exceeds 1 crore but does not exceed 10 crores, this 12% where total income exceeds 10 crores. Clear? And let's see for foreign company. See, for foreign company, it is 2% and 5%. Got it? It is 2% and 5%. Where it is 2% and where it is 5%? Same thing. It is 2% where total income is greater than 1 crore but less than 10 crores. Where it is 5%? Where total income exceeds 10 crores. Clear? And for cooperative societies, local authority firm, it is straightforward. If TITI total income exceeds rupees 1 crore, then at 12%. That's it, only one category. Clear? So this way you can summarize surcharge. I hope you have understood surcharge. Clear? Can I go ahead? Are you following it? Now, one more thing I should discuss with you to conclude this rate of tax, that is the concept of rebate. Understand? What is the concept? It is the concept of rebate under section 87A. It's a very important concept. Rebate means discount, some type of discount or some type of concession. So this 87A gives rebate for individual SSE. Which individual SSE? For individual SSE whose total income does not exceed. So you know these provisions which we are discussing are applicable for individual SSE whose total income does not exceed rupees 5 lakhs during a PY. During the PY. Okay. What is the rebate amount? Rebate amount is tax payable or rupees 12,500, of course, whichever is less. It has a very important implication, my dear friends. It just simply means that if your income is not exceeding 5 lakhs as an individual, your tax payable will directly become zero. Now, how? Very simple point I'll explain you. Individual has TI, total income of rupees 3,50,000 in PY 19-20. Correct? Now you have become expert. How will you calculate tax? See, 0 to 2.5 lakhs, no tax. 2.5 lakhs to 3,50,000. That is on 1 lakh, you will calculate tax at 5%, which will be equal to rupees 5,000. But less rebate. Why rebate? Why rebate? Correct. Because total income is not exceeding 5 lakh. Rebate of how much? Full 5,000. That is basically 5,000 or 12,500, whichever is less. So tax payable will become zero. Of course, if it is exactly 5 lakhs also, it will happen like 12,500 minus 12,500, and tax payable will become eventually zero. That's why I'm saying that indirectly, no need to pay tax for an individual if his total income is not exceeding rupees 5 lakh for PY 1920, that is AY 2021. Clear? So please keep in mind, especially the CS professional student friends. Of course, for CA intermediate, there will be a direct application. in the exam, direct tax liability questions will be asked. For CS professional students, keep in mind that you are asked questions of Section 91, that is in international tax, computation of tax liability by applying unilateral relief. Indirectly, what you have to calculate tax liability there of an individual or some SSE. So at that time, you have to take into consideration all the points of computing rates of tax which we have discussed in this session. Got it? And yes, for CS executive students, so directly they will ask question, they may ask question of calculating tax liability. Correct. So apply this point in the exam systematically. Correct? What normal rates of tax, rebate, surcharge, and health and education says. You should apply it very properly in the exam. Is the discussion clear till now? Correct? So I will go to one point that is pending. Let's see now that what is being yet to be discussed. Salary be discussed, HPB discussed, PGB be discussed, capital gain discussed, very good. Taxation of companies discussed in session one, TDS TCS discussed, rates of income tax discussed. What is pending now? Yes, deductions of chapter 6A. This is the only small thing pending. Let us discuss it. Correct? So you know the position of deduction of chapter 6A. Where is the position of deduction of chapter 6A? Correct. You add all five heads of income, take into consideration clubbing set off carry forward, you get something called as gross total income, then you do less deductions of chapter 6A, and then you get total income. So deductions under chapter 6A are always beneficial. They take your total income down, so of course your tax liability also goes down. So now let's see which sections are there, some sections which are inserted by this Finance Act 19. Okay, is to help the SSEs and so that SSEs can claim these deductions. There are only two which are inserted, which you have to discuss. Of course, all other continues as it is. 80C to 80U. Let's see. 80EEA. Okay, you know, E series is for loan, interest on loan. 80E is interest on educational loan, higher education loan. 80EE is interest on housing loan, which was sanctioned in that particular PY. Correct? 16, 17. Yes. Now 80EEA is inserted and 80EEB is inserted. Same, it is a series, it's a deduction for interest on some loan. So this 80EEA is deduction in respect of interest payable on loan taken for acquisition of residential house property. 80EEA. Correct? Let me discuss interest on housing loan gets deduction where all? Correct. It gets deduction under section 24B. That is under HP, while calculating HP. Some thing can get deduction under 80EE. Of course, if those very specific conditions are satisfied. And now 80EEA. Of course, conditions, a lot of conditions are there. Let's see. What is 80EEA? An individual who has taken a loan for acquisition of residential house property from any financial institution, okay, is eligible SSE. Interest payable on such loan would qualify for deduction under this section. But of course, it comes with a lot of conditions. Because if any benefit is to be given to you, then they will ensure that you have satisfied the conditions. Okay. The stamp duty value of the house should not exceed 45 lakhs. Correct? In 80EE, there was a point that value of the house should not exceed 50 lakhs. Now 80EEA says that stamp duty value of the house should not exceed 45 lakhs. Sorry. Then they are saying individual should not own any residential house on date of sanction of loan, and the individual should not be eligible to claim deduction of 80EE. They cannot give you benefits of two deductions simultaneously. That's why this condition. And loan should be sanctioned by financial institution when? During PY 1920. So very important conditions I'm understanding. That is SDV, stamp duty value of house, should be less than or equal to rupees 45 lakhs. Correct? Then this should be assessee's first house as on date of sanction of the loan. What should be the sanction date? Sanction of loan should be during PY or FY 1920. Correct? Did you understand these conditions? These are very three important conditions. The benefit of deduction under this section would be available from AY 2021 and subsequent AYS till the repayment of loan continues. And very important, quantum of deduction. Quantum of deduction means ceiling limit. This quantum of deduction will tell you ceiling limit, and here ceiling limit would be rupees 1,50,000. Keep it in mind, ceiling limit is rupees 1,50,000, of course, per annum. Mind you, 80EE, which we have discussed in our main sessions, has limit of 50,000, but this has a good limit of 1,50,000. See, the maximum deduction allowable is rupees 1,50,000. This deduction of up to rupees 1,50,000 under 80EA is over and above deduction of 24B in respect of interest payable on loan borrowed for acquisition of residential house property. In respect of self-occupied HP, you know, interest deduction under 24B is restricted to rupees 2 lakhs. This you know. In case of LO, means let out, or DLO, deemed to be let out property, even though there is no limit under 24B, section 71, subsection 3A, that is of set off and carry forward, restricts the amount of loss from HP to be set off against other head only to the extent of rupees 2 lakhs. Accordingly, if interest payable in respect of acquisition of eligible house property is more than rupees 2 lakhs, then this excess can be accommodated in 80EEA, of course, subject to fulfillment of conditions. Clear? So, in short, if 3,20,000 is interest on borrowed capital in case of HP, okay, where the loan was taken in PY 1920 for such house, which is the first house on date of sanction of loan, and sanction of loan is made in PY 1920, then 2 lakhs will be claimed as deduction under 24B, and balance 120 will be claimed as deduction in 80EEA. Why entire 120 I am saying? Because it is not exceeding 1,50,000. Clear? And of course, interest allowed as deduction under section 80EEA will not be allowed as deduction under any other provisions of the Act for the same or any other assessment year. Clear? So no double deductions of the interest, which is once allowed under 80EEA. Clear? So 80E we discussed in main sessions. Now we discuss 80EEA here. Clear? Let's go ahead. Let's see section 80EEB. You know that Indian government is trying to encourage use of electric vehicles. So this 80EB seeks to give deduction with respect to interest on loan which is taken for acquisition of such electric vehicles. Clear? Let's see. Deduction in respect of interest payable on loan taken for purchase of electric vehicle. Who is eligible, SSE? See, an individual who has taken a loan for purchase, individual, can you handle an individual who has taken loan for purchase of electric vehicle from any financial institution? Interest payable on such loan would qualify for deduction under this section. So say you are doing job in a company. That means you are earning income from salary, and you are purchasing a normal vehicle, which is run on petrol, diesel, normal vehicle. And you take loan for purchasing such vehicle. On this loan, you are paying any interest. Such interest will not be allowed as deduction under any section. Such interest for you is a luxury. Meaning to say, such car is a luxury and no deduction under any section. But at the same, if you purchase instead of that petrol or diesel vehicle, if you purchase electric vehicle, then whatever interest you are paying on the loan of purchase of electric vehicle, that would be allowed as deduction under the Section 80 EB. Okay, that is the point. So for the first time in the history of Income Tax Act, they have got some deduction for individual SSE, some deduction for interest on vehicles loan for individual SSE. But mind you, that vehicle should be electric vehicle. So see conditions. Such loan should be taken on purchase of an electric vehicle. SSC should be an individual. Of course, if he has business, then he can claim it under normal provisions of PGBP. You are matured enough to understand that. Loan should be sanctioned by financial institution, and loan should be sanctioned during 1st April 2019 to 31st March 2023. So within this 4 years, 1920, 2021, 2022, 21, 22, and 22, 23. Within these 4 financial years, they want to increase the sale of electric vehicles. Means they want to promote these electric vehicles. Hence, they have given this window. The benefit of deduction under this section would be available from AY 2021 and subsequent AYs till repayment of loan continues. And quantum of deduction will be, in ceiling limit is given of 1,50,000 during per annum. And of course, if you allow deduction under 80 EB for such interest on loan, you will not be allowed deduction under any other provisions. Means if you are doing business, and for the use of business, for the use in business, you take electric vehicle, and you have taken loan for this electric vehicle and paying interest on that, and this interest if you claim as deduction while calculating PGBP, then you will not be again allowed deduction under 80 EB. Or if you have claimed under 80 EB, then you cannot claim under the provisions of PGBP. So of course, that interest paid once will be allowed as deduction only once, either under PGBP provisions or under 80 EB provisions. So I hope you understood why I'm saying that this benefit will be for non-business people, because business people anyways always claimed deduction of such interest. So let me quickly summarize these conditions. Loan should be taken by individual, correct? Then it is the deduction is for what? Deduction is for interest on what? On loan for what? For purchase, that is acquisition of what? Of electric vehicle. They have not said motor car, they have said vehicle. So it will include two-wheeler also, in my opinion, moped. I don't have good examples for this to give, because still we are in the primary stage, and exactly that is the reason why they have given this deduction. Individual for this purpose. Okay, the loan should be between 1st April 2019 to 31st March 2023. Yes or no? I hope you got the point. And my handwriting is legible. Anyways, we have discussed it. I have given you in typed form also. And ceiling limit is rupees 1,50,000 per annum. Clear? And if deduction allowed under Section 80 EEB, then not again allowed under any other section, then not again allowed under any other section. I hope I have covered the points. Clear? So, shall we once recap quickly in which areas I have to learn the important amendments, and then we can conclude this session 2 and the last session for the amendments of income tax. Okay, it was really fun bringing all these amendments to you, because you know some change always gives you know some thinking edge to the mind, and that keeps us young. So always take amendments and changes positively. One, salary. You know, standard deduction 50,000 instead of 40,000. Second, house property. Now two houses can be shown as self-occupied instead of one house. And also the change that for these two houses together, the loss cannot exceed rupees 2 lakhs. PGBP, depreciation on motor vehicles, 30%/45%. You know, 45% for those motor vehicles which are used in business of running them on hire. And you know, these should be purchased between 23rd August 2019 to 31st March 2020 for this percentages of depreciation. This is to boost, bring boost in sale of those cars. Then in capital gains, you know, PY 1920 or FY 1920 CII is 289. This you know. And you have understood that there is an amendment in section 54. If your capital gains on sale of one house is not exceeding 2 crores, you have now option in investing in 2 houses in India. Okay, but this option will be given only once. Then, amendment in deductions under chapter 6A. Where were the amendments? There were two new sections inserted, 80EA and 80EEB. Yes or no? Then TDS, two new sections inserted, 194M and 194N. Then taxation for companies, taxation of companies, MAT rate is 15% instead of 18.5%, it is now 15%. And 115BAA and 115BAB. Also don't forget 115QA's amendment, that 115QA now applicable also for listed shares. Then rates of tax we discussed, but rates of tax you read along with surcharge and read along with plus means along with, otherwise you will see what I am saying. Surcharge and read along with rebate of 87A. And more importantly, see where all these things will affect in your calculation. And clear, na? So salary 50,000 is standard deduction under section 16(1A). HP, two houses, SO, and total loss from HP rupees 2 lakhs. So to the extent possible, I am trying to simplify it. PGBP, depreciation on motor car, 30%. When the purchase should be from 23rd August 2019 to 31st March 2020. And you know, if I say slash 45, and that 45 is for whom, you know that, correct? And 54's amendment is LTCG less than or equal to rupees 2 crores, then investment in 2 houses. How is this? This is optional. Clear? EA is for house. EB is for electric vehicle. So you know some remember some short means you can say short words and try to keep it in mind. 194M had ceiling limit, I mean threshold of 50 lakhs and percentage of TDS is 5. Personal payments I told you. 194N is cash withdrawals. So you know while studying, study in detail and then summarize it in short. Clear? That is the fundamental of learning income tax. Also we have applied all the things. So I hope that these sessions were helpful to you. Please let me know your feedback about it. And if any doubts, as I told you, always feel free to contact me. So my dear friends, I am ending this video at this point. And at this juncture, I am wishing you all the very best for your exams. Apply these things. Do the best. Stay healthy. Stay safe. Thank you.